you do for yourself depends on what you think of yourself. What you think of yourself depends on what you know of yourself. And what you know of yourself depends on what you have been told. Great Dawn and Grand Rising, Cleveland, Ohio, 360 Info Network, right here on AM 1490 WERE. And on the line, we have our brother, our HNIC, my brother, Antonio.
Good, what's happening, Good morning, welcome, Yeah, how's it going, Vince? How's everything?
It's all good, man. We got a great show lined up. I'm sure you're going to be blown away by the brothers that we are about to bring to you and their new book. It's called Spears of the Mossi, A Historical Survey of the Minds of African Warrior Scholars, Volume 1. So we're going to talk to Ini-Herit, Shawn P. Khalfani, and the brother who brings it all together, Brother Kofi Piesie, in just a few moments.
All right, well, that's good, yeah. Before we get started, too, I want to let our listeners know that we're going to be having a local business come on July 25th. You know, this COVID thing is spiking up on us, and some of them might have retail businesses, or some of them might, you know, have restaurants or something to the light where they deal with the public. You know, so everyone is, you know, still staying tuned to this COVID piece that is going on and trying to keep their businesses open. So this local business is going to be talking about how they can keep themselves safe and how to keep their patrons safe dealing with this COVID. They have a system that you can see the results on how it's working. It's less labor intensive to where they wouldn't have to sanitize as often as they would normally or having someone doing it. So people can even use, you know, some of the products for their home as well. So we want to prime them and prepare them for, and maybe they may know some people that is in the retail business or restaurant business to tune in on the 25th of July. We'll have this local business on. I think it's going to be something very useful, very hot, and very good for people because you kind of like don't know what you're doing out there. And what I mean, you maybe think you're cleaning and sanitizing something, but you're going to be able to see what you're doing and how you're doing it, and they're going to have some a process to where you can see the results that you're having. So, you know, to keep you safe and keep your patrons safe and to make them feel comfortable when they're in your establishment or your home. So the 25th, make sure you tune in. If you know someone has a restaurant or a business or something they like where they deal with the public, make sure to tune in on the 25th.
Okay. So without any further ado, we want to bring into the room Brother Ini-Herit, Shawn P. Khalfani. I hope I'm pronouncing your name right, brother. And Brother Kofi Piesie, who has put together something called the Kofi Piesie Research Team. They've written a very significant document. It's called Spears of the Mossi, A Historical Survey of the Minds of African Warrior Scholars, Volume 1. They've been making some inroads in Cleveland. I witnessed them last night on Brother Kevin Chill Hurd's Facebook page. They had a live shot that they did last night. I've been seeing them on the airwaves on Facebook and on YouTube, and they are doing some huge things when it comes to African-centered scholarship. So, again, bringing to the airwaves Brother Kofi Piesie and my brother Shawn P. Welcome to 360 Info Network.
Good morning.
Good morning.
All right. Brother Kofi, I want to start with you. You have your name on this project, and I'm sure there were probably people out there who are wondering who is or what is Kofi Piesie. So let's start with you giving us an explanation of what Kofi Piesie is all about.
Well, Kofi Piesie, it's me. Kofi Piesie is an independent researcher, a person who is trying to find the truth, a person who is trying to share information, which the phrase I use as I learn, we all learn, is something I'm trying to demonstrate as much as possible. The more I learn, I think it's important that the things that we learn, we should share those things with everyone else.
Okay. All right. And let's go over to my brother, Shawn. Give us a little background on, give us some background on yourself.
Yeah, my name is Shawn. Well, you know me, but on Facebook, it's Ini-Herit, Shawn Khalfani. The name simply means he who brings back the lost shall lead. And in the climate that we're in, you know, we face some terrible times. You know, we've been miseducated, misrepresented. And so I thought the name Ini-Herit Khalfani would be appropriate to bring back that truth, that information to those who are lost. And, you know, like Kofi, I'm an independent researcher. We are part of a few groups together, the Sesh U Mani Metal Nature, a group which we deal with the Sesh, or what other people may know as the hieroglyphs or the Egyptian writing script. And then the Mossi Warrior Clan as well, a group of individuals who are bringing West Africa to America, per se, in our research. And then, of course, the Kofi Piesie Research Team, which is, you know, young African warrior scholars following in the footprints of our elders and ancestors.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Brother Kofi, tell us what the genesis was for your research team. Why did you put it together? And you alluded to it earlier, but could you give us some more insight on your objectives?
Well, basically, I think around 2016, like Shawn said, I'm a member of the Mossi Warrior. We both are members of the Mossi Warrior Clan, which we both of those groups have YouTube channels. I started my own YouTube channel, Kofi Piesie TV, and just looking back on when I first came into what they call the so-called conscious community, no one was really, before I get to the Mossi Warrior Clan and the Sesh U, no one would give me a chance. So once I got my YouTube channel established and started making some noise, I wanted to bring in people that I knew that probably wouldn't give a chance, or I just thought that they were highly intellectual. So over the years, me and Shawn was in a group. So Shawn came on and blessed the channel. And then I just started looking at other individuals online who I thought, you know, may be highly intellectual and have something to share with the people. So it just started out with inviting these brothers on, T'Challa, who's also with T'Challa Bangala, who's a member of Kofi Piesie Research Team, Vasa Niccolo Gullah, Brunkin Mong, Satepin Ra Mariama, who's also in the group with us, the Sesshu Ma'ani Metanetra. And these guys just started doing presentations. So inviting them on, doing presentations, just giving them a chance so people can see what they have to offer. And then we brung on Sute, and it just started off as the Kofi Piesie family in the Phillies. Every time they did something on the channel, I just called them my brothers and my family. So we just started off Kofi Piesie family in the Phillies. And then it turned into a research team. People started liking to see what we had to say, each individual had to say. And each one of us have our own lane. So I just thought it was important to put this group together. And then we talked about offline all the time, because we build on the weekend about putting out published works, because we want to follow in the footsteps of our ancestors. So we don't want to just be online on YouTube or on Facebook just going live or putting up posts. We wanted to actually started putting things in our published works. So, you know, we put this great work, I would like to say, Spears of the Mind, the Historical Survey of the Minds of African Warrior Scholars, out. But like I said, basically just start out with me picking some guys, seeing some guys online, and, inviting him on the channel, and it eventually turned into the Kofi Piesie Research Team.
Okay. We're going to dig a little bit.
I got a question. Okay. One question. It may be where Vince is going, or what I just wanted to ask you guys. Like you say, seeing your younger brothers and doing what you do, and that is commendable as well. How do you feel about the younger folks as far as taking on this way of this thought process, this new birth, this consciousness that for some, how is it affecting the young folks? What kind of, any pushback or any receptiveness of dealing with some of the younger brothers with this type of knowledge? Are they open now since, people protesting and Juneteenth and now? You had your brother Nipsey Hussle that kind of woke some people up. So what kind of reception are you getting from the young brothers? Because that's going to be the, and sisters, that's going to be the ones that's going to take us forward.
You want to go, Shawn, or you want me to start?
I'll say something real quick. You can veg it back. The what we're hearing from younger brothers and sisters is to push forward, to continue to do our work. We're being, they're receptive to what's being received because it's something that they're not learning or being taught in school. Even the people that are our age and older have applauded our efforts as far as trying to reach and teach those of us who don't have a way or a direction. And so in that, we try to cover a vast part of African and African-American history that is crucial in, bringing truth to light. And I say that because of the misconceptions and the narrative that has been painted on us for hundreds of years. Oh, you were just slaves. You hear that, it's almost as if it's cliche. Oh, you were slaves before you were brought here. So the fact that the youth know that they were more than slaves, and they know that they come from very wealthy and rich cultural tradition, culture and traditions, then they can gravitate back toward that. But it's we're growing, and we appreciate the opportunities that we've had thus far, and we're going to continue to do our work so that we will reach to the masses. And I'll get back to something Kofi once said a while back later in the show that I want to bring to light right now.
Okay. It's 11:17 on AM 1490 WERE. You're listening to 360 Info Network. I'm Vince Robinson along with Hamtonio, and we are talking to Kofi Piesie and Shawn P. of the Kofi Piesie Research Team. We're going to take a quick break, and we will be back to get an explanation of who the Mossi are and why Spears of the Mossi is significant. We'll be back with more 360 Info Network right after this.
You have a little over 50 seconds, guys.
Okay.
Great show so far.
Thank you.
Welcome. Stand by.
Okay. We're back on 360 Info Network, Vince Robinson and Hamtonio, and we are speaking with Shawn P. and Kofi Piesie of the Kofi Piesie Research Team about their very important publication, Spears of the Mossi, a historical survey of the minds of African warrior scholars, volume one. Kofi, I'll present this question to you. Could you talk to us about the significance of the title Spears of the Mossi and who are or were the Mossi?
Okay. Spears of the Mossi. It's something that we came up with, Spears of the Mossi. Basically, we're using spears as a symbolism as a pen. Hold on, y'all. Can y'all hear me?
Yes, we hear you.
I got a bad echo. Hold on, let me take these headphones off. I'm sorry.
Okay.
God, I can't hardly hear myself.
Okay, we good?
Yeah, you want me to answer for him?
Yes, please.
All right, so basically how it all came about is that we were putting our thoughts together on, you know, what was going to be next, because we were doing presentations on YouTube, like we said, and then we all came up with the idea of, let's put a project out, similar to what we in the SESU have done before, and also the Shimsu Heru Research Team, which is a group project our teachers put together and put out for the community that kind of shook up the community as far as the meaning of the place name Kemet, which was introducing a hypothesis into the scientific field, you know, just kind of submitting something. So we wanted to follow in the steps of our teachers, like we said, and do something that was monumental, you know, stand on something. So the title came about by brother T'Challa. He's had this idea for a while, and when he came up with the title name, you know, everybody just didn't move on off of that, and that was the title of the book. That's what the book was going to be, hands down, nothing else to go about or say about it, right? It was the perfect fit. And that's why you see the Mossi Warrior Clan present, because the Mossi Warrior Clan, which Brother Kofi Piesie and myself are a part of that research team as well, you know, it was a collective. So that's why you see Brother Uncle Kett in the Dedicated Forward and Brother Benjamin Njai in the forward of the book, because they are also members of the Mossi Warrior Clan, founders of the Mossi Warrior Clan. So we wanted to pay our homage and respects to our brothers, so we had them lead the way in our very first publication. So who are the Mossi? The Mossi are from West Africa. The Mossi rejected foreign religion for a long time. They were able to hold on to their traditions and culture for a long time. They didn't want no part of Islam, which was their first. They didn't. They rejected every ounce of it. They didn't want it. They just stuck to their ways, the traditional ways. You know, they're very, very important people in history. And I say that because it gives the foundation to this work. Knowing, you know, what we know about them culturally, that went into all of our efforts to bring that about. And you'll hear more about them, but that's just a small synopsis.
Okay. And I noticed that, you know, and within the text.
Okay, and they're from the west coast of Africa?
Yeah.
Yes, they're
which country would you? Yeah.
Oh, my bad. I'm back, too. Now, you can find them in Burkina Faso. You can find them in Mali. Okay. You can find them in Sanghe.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. That's good. Well, and that's a lot of, you know, a lot of the problems we have, you know, and not controlling the information, the narrative, and history like that, because there's so many things like this that we never heard of in traditions and cousins. And a lot of times people just think when we think about Africa, think people just laid down and conformed and assimilated to everything that the colonizers put on us. But you had people, you know, fighting and stand with their culture, even if it had to do it in secrecy and things of that nature, because we never think about in this time when we were captured and brought over here as slaves. What was going on over in Africa? You know, was they just having a good time at the beach and enjoying themselves? No, they was being suppressed and things was being opposed and their leaders were being killed. They're just the same as what was going on over here in America at the time. So we never tend to think about that, but the system has put us in a place that, you know, like they think over in this country, you know, once they put the whip on somebody's back, we just conformed and then rebelled. There were several rebellions that took place here, but the system don't want us to, you know, talk about that and, you know, don't give us no ideas in resisting, you know, oppression.
Right. Absolutely. I think the biggest thing that you said was that ending part, that, you know, just they just think that they cracked the whip and we submitted. No. There's countless revolts that transpired during the kidnapping of our ancestors, countless. And I'm speaking on the continent, in the Americas, on the ships, and going in whatever direction they could send us to, the Iberian slave trade. There was countless revolts. So we have to look at this. It's not something you can put a Band-Aid on. This Holocaust happened, and it was the largest in world history. So we have to be careful about that and tell our story.
Yes. You know, it's interesting that you would bring
absolutely
that up.
Absolutely. In agreement.
Brother Shawn. You know,
that's why it's important for us to have networks like this and you guys doing the things that you do. We all have to be talking heads out there to make something happen. But let me say one thing, too. I know in my journey and, you know, awakening and, you know, for a lot of years and, you know, sometimes, you know, going down this particular path, it can be lonely, you know, and people look, you know, because you're not walking to the same beat that everybody else is and you're kind of trying to stir up things and open their eyes. But and it could be a lonely path. And I think at this particular time, and, you know, and you guys probably, if you're not there, you know, you're going to be there, you know, along with me, is that we got to start this conscious community, putting some tangible things that if we're going to take our people from this point to the next point, you know, they have to have some tangible, something they can hold. I don't know if it's institutions or show, you know, making us some type of connection between that to where they can go back and actually see, feel, touch these particular communities, because, you know, some of my elders would say, if you take something away from them, you got to replace it for something. And so we taking the way that we know of Christianity away from them, you got to give the people something else to replace it, you know. So, you know, my plight right now has what I've been saying to the conscious community. Okay, we read enough, you know, on some things. You know, we got to put some tangibles together so, you know, our people can, you know, feel, touch, and see some things, you know?
Speaking of...
Yeah, we had to create some... I'll let you go in a minute, Shawn. We had to create some institutions. That's one thing. Mm-hmm. You know, we done a lot of reading. You know what I'm saying?
Yes,
done
sir.
A lot of talking. Mm-hmm. Now it's time to put institutions into place. And what I mean by institutions... far as schools, especially for the kids. That's my main thing for the kids, because right now, if you look in the school system, which I call the food system, a lot of you know, our kids is in that system, they is learning low self-esteem, you know. So and what I mean by they learning low self-esteem, they're learning about someone else's culture and how great another group of people or another race of people is, and how inferior their group of people is. The only time they learn a little something of value of black people is in Black History Month. The rest of the year, they're learning about these Greeks and these Romans, you know, who did this and that, and then they paint a picture like they civilized the world. So a lot of our kids are having a low self-esteem, you know, and they're being taught that I ain't nothing, so therefore I'm not going to be nothing. So and to look towards someone else that are looking toward themselves for greatness, they're looking outside of themselves to someone else for greatness. So we have to first set up those institutions for the, you know what I'm saying, for the kids. And even with those institutions, we have to teach within them not only about our history, but we have to teach them about the current things that's going on. We need to teach them about politics. We need to teach them about economics, you know, teach them about agriculture, about farming, you know what I'm saying, teach them about circulating the dollar in their community. So it's so many different things that we have, you know, that we have to do that's involved in these institutions. And then, you know, I think that would help for as the future. Now, there's been plans put together in numerous books, you know, to activate some of the things that we should be putting in motion right now. But I just, you know, people just fail to, I guess, you know, a lot of us just too lazy to implement some of those things into action, because the time is now to start put things into action. The talking is you know, the talking is over with. It's time to, like I said, put those things into action. But yeah, like you said, first we got to start with those institutions. You know, that's my thing.
Yeah, Shawn,
I agree.
Did you want to add to that?
I just want to add to something that you said earlier about that lonely place. Kofi's been there at that lonely place. You know, we feel these moments where it's like we're trying to do as much as we can, but it's not being heard, or the right people are not receiving the information or supporting the fact that we're making a conscious effort for years to try to bring truth to light and to inspire and invoke change in the community, you know, whether it's in our own cities and otherwise. However, I don't know if he want to speak about this or not, but, you know, it's, you know, sometimes I force or push him to get past that. You know what I mean? Like, I know when he's in a rough spot mentally, and like, man, we just doing a lot of work. Like, we reading, we trying to put forth some efforts, we trying to inspire, uplift, and uphold the ways of our ancestors and bring back to the real traditions and the customs, things that we lost, you know, for years. And and then he'd be like, man, I just, you know, sometimes he just say he want to give up, and I'd be like, man, listen, it's not about everybody else, it's about the babies, you know what I'm saying? Because he got kids, I got kids. So that's something tangible that he can see right now. And then he knows that his stepdaughter's listening, his son's listening, there are other people's children's listening, you know, Chavis's kids is listening. They're practicing learning to read our book. They're just, you know, they got to be about 4 or 5 years old. And that's inspiring, that's motivational. And then the support that has gone, you know, that we've garnered over the last few months since we dropped the book has just been phenomenal for us. So ultimately, man, you know, we're just, you know, we're honored by the ancestors and everyone who's actually played an active part in trying to, you know, help us.
I want to talk a little bit about the importance of,
absolutely,
of scholarship.
Absolutely. You know, it's a rough, it can be a rough road. What has been encouragement for me is understanding this, because I've faced that many, many, many times over. You know, you just be like, you know, they just don't see, don't want to see, and that's the brainwashing that has taken place. But what has been encouragement to keep me going is understanding, through historical viewpoint, it never was the masses of the people who made the change. It always was a small group of people that made the change, and the masses, the sheeple, just followed. You know, so that's why I reach out to the conscious community to say, hey, let's put some tangible things together, and we can steer this direction of where our people go. And I think it's all about timing. I think an awakening is taking place across the planet, and so sometimes, you know, a lot of our great leaders have came and gone, you know, and left their jewels, and somebody else picked it up, and they didn't get the momentum that they should have had in the past. But a lot of times, things are timing, you know, and the right, our ancestors talked about timing. So we, you know, you may get, you know, a bigger push towards this now because it could be the timing going into this new age and things of that nature. So their job in the past was just to keep the torch lit, possibly for guys like yourself to pick it up and move forward into the proper timing. So, you know, that could be some encouragement.
The time has come.
Yeah, because, I mean, like he said, at times for me, I mean, it has been plenty of times I've been wanting to tap out, you know, because we hadn't reached the people I think we need to reach. Like he said, we do a lot, and I sacrifice, and he do too, and a lot of other members of the group too, we sacrifice time. So, and I know time is important. I know especially to me, man, I get on people all the time if they waste my time. So I just feel like sometimes the time be wasted, and we put all this work for it, you know what I'm saying? And we put what we got on hold so we can try to help the people in whatever form of
absolutely mm-hmm.
and help the people, you know, and then mm-hmm. sometimes it's not received, you know, like it should be received. So, you know, and a lot of times it feel like it in vain. I'm just speaking for me. So sometimes it just makes me want to, you know, tap out, but I'm glad I have, like, even with some, you know, with some of the things that you just said, and then Shawn all the time, who keeps me encouraged, man. And like you said, it was a small mass of the people who, you know, who pushed forward and did what they had to do in order to help our people in whatever form or capacity, man. And, you know, it definitely get lonely at time. I'm from Mississippi, so, and this is the Bible Belt over here, so a lot of people is not so, you know, it's I'm, you know, I'm kind of an outcast. I'm kind of like a
so,
you know, anything I speak on, you know, if I'm not talking about the Bible in general, any of those characters in the Bible, you know, people are looking at me like I have, you know, lost my mind.
Yeah, brother. Stay strong, brother. Stay strong. Absolutely.
Yeah, but I'm, you know, I'm pushing through, and we all pushing, you know, pushing through, because my main objective is I keep saying my opinion, because I know Shawn can speak for himself and other members can speak for themselves, but my main objective is the babies. You know, I'm not too much, you know, I'm studying the grown folks. My main thing is the babies and what's going to happen in these next generations. So that's my aim, and that's my focus. So, and I think that's what's hopefully keep me going.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I got you.
11:37 on AM 1490
WRE. Yep. Vince, you still there?
Yes, I am. It's 11:37 on AM 1490 WERE. You're listening to 360 Info Network with Hamtonio and Vince Robinson. We're interviewing Kofi Piesie and Shawn P. of the Kofi Piesie Research Team. The time has come for us to truly finance our freedom and support each other's efforts to heal and continue to build our community strongly. For 15 years following Lynn Hampton's lead, we have freely given of our time and effort to bring you quality programming every week. We know that our listenership is vast in Cleveland and on the internet, and now we must expand our reach and crystallize our focus. It's a smart choice to advertise your organization or your business with 360 Info Network Radio. Grow with us, support our weekly advertisers, support their businesses because they are quality and they make our efforts possible. And I just wanted to give a shout out to a new sponsor that's coming aboard. It is the New East Side Market, a grocery wellness community in the heart of the community at 10505 St. Clair Avenue. That's at East 105th and St. Clair. They are doing a number of things, including bringing fresh produce into this area, which has been redlined in terms of nutrition. Brothers, I want to dive into the book. I have read half of it. I got up to Shawn P's chapter and I was blown away by his chapter. I started reading Kofi's chapter that explains religion, and it's a very thorough description of religion as we know it. And it's definitely vital information for us to know. Also wanted to mention that, you know, the whole idea of scholarship is increasingly important, because the greatest threat to this system of pseudo supremacy is African intellectual thought. So if you could talk about what's in the book, what we can get from it, and why scholarship is so important.
I'll start and then show you. I'll be brief. You know, the book is very important. Like I mentioned earlier, low self-esteem. I think the book will definitely give our people some type of self-esteem, encourage them. My chapter, well, you want me to start with my chapter or...
You can start with your chapter, but I just want the listening audience to get an idea of what you're talking about in the book, because it's extremely vital. And I really appreciate the marriage between West African and Northeast African and just the history of the entire continent as it relates to Africans who are here in America and in the diaspora.
Okay. Well, yeah, basically, the book is a survey. It's a survey in the minds of young African scholars. So it deal with various topics in the book. And I just start with my chapter. Well, I got two chapters in there, but I just start with one chapter, education, the miseducation. Let me see what the name of my chapter is. But anyway, my chapter, it deals with religion. So I'm basically trying to get people to understand about how we are using misleading terms. Like most people, if you don't agree with the Christian or the Judaism or the Islam paradigm, you know, you are heathen, you are pagan, you are infidel. So these are terms that we use that was that foreigners, European explorers, prejudiced anthropologists use. Also, we use the terms, even those who are reading and studying, they use these misleading terms. When you deal with African traditions, you will hear the word juju, which they have took the word juju like we took the N word and flipped it and made it a durin. But you hear the word, the derogatory term like juju. You hear the derogatory term like primitive, fetish. These are all misleading terms that comes from, again, the European explorer, the foreigner, and et cetera. Also dealing with comparing the two religions. You have people that don't understand African traditions. So they'll compare the three Western religions, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, to African traditions. There are many, many, many African African traditions. They are the same, but they are different. If we talk about Odinani, which is a tradition out of Nigeria that the Igbo practice, is different than the people, also the people in Nigeria that are the Yoruba people that practice Ifa. If we talk about the people in Togo and Benin, they practice voodoo. They practice Voodoo. So they practice Voodoo. If you go to East Africa, you will see the Chui people. Their tradition may be called the Gulu or Kulu. So all these different traditions are the same, but they are different. But people compare the three Western religions with these traditions. And I was just trying to break down and give people understanding that the African traditions are different than these three Western religions. The three Western religions is combined by a book. You have the Christians who are buying by the New and Old Testament, what they call the Holy Bible. You have the Judaism faith of the Jews or the Hebrew who are buying by the Torah, the Tanakh. And you have the Muslims who are buying by the Quran. African traditions is not buying by any book. So I was just trying to show the comparison between the two and give people some understanding on where these terms come from and how different African tradition is from the three Western religions. So we have to stop making a comparison between those traditions and
and African traditions. That's just one other rule of one of my chapters. Another chapter is procreation, getting people to understand about how in African culture, when we talk about procreation, we have to talk about marriage, how important marriage is. So, and I believe that marriage is the most sacred rite when we deal with the rites of passages. Rites of passages is something that we need to implement and bring back here. But in each African tradition, whether you go to East Africa, South Africa, West Africa, North Africa, those rites of passages is a demarcation stages of life. And one of those demarcation stages of life is marriage. And marriage is the most important rite, in my opinion. But when you talk about marriage, you have to talk about procreation. You cannot talk about procreation without marriage. And procreation is very important because we understand in African traditions, it's not an individual thing. It is a us thing. It is a community thing. So when you are able to have children, two hands are better than four hands. Four hands is better than six hands. So they understand that children is a asset and a children is a value. Children is not only an asset in the family, but it's also an asset in your community. It's an asset in your tribe. It's an asset in your clan. Those are some, and I'm just trying to move real quick because I know we pressed on time. Shawn can speak on his chapters, but each part of those chapters, each one of us have our own lane where we present a certain particular part of the history. Like you have Satepara, he deals with the human zoo. So he talk about scientific racism. He talks about the human zoos over here in America. T'Challa, he talks about various things with music in his thing because he deals with music. That's his lane. Vasa talks about the greatness in Africa. So he starts off at an earlier period in Africa. Like I say, it's a vast of different information, but I'll stop and let Shawn go on.
Okay. Before we hear from Shawn, we're going to take a quick break and hear from one of our sponsors, and we will return with more 360 Info Network Radio right after this message from our sponsor. We'll be right back.
Hi, Chuck Conaway Jr. here for NEP's Black...
50 seconds, guys.
Okay.
All right.
Wings Crazy every Tuesday and Thursday with 60 Cent Whole Wings. That's NEP's located at 3216 East 93rd Street in the Kinsman Square Plaza, or you may get them a call at area code 216-429-2356. And I'm once again, area code 216-429-2356. That's NEP's Black Wall Street Cafe as they go Wings Crazy every Tuesday and Thursday, 60 Cent Whole Wings. NEP's Black Wall Street Cafe, hours are open Tuesday through Thursday.
Stand by.
Friday and Saturday, 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. and Sundays, 11 a.m. to 6 p.m. NEP's Black Wall Street Cafe, we'll see you there.
We're back on 360 Info Network Radio. I'm Vince Robinson with Hamtonio. Just want to shout out to a few folks who are viewing us on Facebook right now, which include Mary Olunye, Ismael Douglas, Jacqueline Dickerson Turner, Robert Pepper, Sadiqa Hennigan, and Donna Dabbs, who are watching us via Facebook Live. Before we took the break, we wanted to talk to Shawn P. about his chapter. It's a very short chapter. It's chapter 2. And the title of this chapter is Redemption of the African Mind. It's a short chapter, but it's a very powerful chapter. Shawn, tell us about what you communicated in chapter 2 of Spears of the Mossi.
Absolutely. Well, first, let me say this, brothers. I actually wrote this maybe a year and a half ago. The inspiration behind it was the lack of consciousness of the African mind in America. And the fact that we would want to be everything other than who we are traditionally and culturally. Basically, what I'm saying is that we wanted to impersonate the people around us instead of knowing more about who we are and identifying with who we are as a people. Now, when I look back at what I wrote over a year and a half ago and just updated it and brought it forth to the people, we were in a struggle to, you know, what I, because I've written about this topic several, you know, several times before, just in different ways on blogs and things of that nature. But the mind is the, you know, the most terrible thing you could waste, right? You could just waste your mind, and then next thing you know, you're all over the place. So now think about where we are right now in this moment. You see an emergence, you see an acceptance, and then you see, you still see, you see some appreciation and then a lack of appreciation. Now, the majority is a lack of appreciation. But what Africans in America don't know is that everybody else is studying who you were. And here you are, shut off from understanding all of that. They develop scientific fields of study to understand you. What do you think Egyptology is? Right? That's a scientific field of study to know more about the eldest ancestors in that land. They know that, they know the Arabs are foreign to the land. There's no argument there. They know that certain phenotypical type of people were in that land. They're not arguing that. That's somebody else's argument, okay? It's been settled, right? When you talk about the early dynastic periods all the way up through through its fruition, you know, some people like to say before the arrival of the Hyksos, so to say, the Heqanasuq, before them, they know who was ruling in the area. But it didn't matter, you know. None of that we don't have to romance that. But they're studying us. They're studying how we develop things that were so tangible that it's still in use today. Like the medical papyri that's in use today. Operating on brains, fixing bones, broken toes, teeth, medicinal purposes, all of these things that we need to survive today, they're still studying those things. And then we take that for granted. You know, the archaeology, everybody always thrives about the pyramids, so on and so forth. But the archaeology in that day was a technological advancement. They're studying that. There's still questions that many scientists want answers to. You know, DNA has helped solve a lot of questions for people who were curious about the genetic makeup or the phenotypical makeup of the people in the land. We have to thank Sheikh Antijoke, the great ancestor, for that. And others, you know, Theophilo Banga, we have to thank them. So basically in my chapter, I'm trying to get people to, in a short version, I'm trying to get people to understand all of that in its entirety. And that's what chapter two is about. I wrote another chapter this kind of ruffles feathers, but a little bit, but it had to be written. The birth of Kemetic Christianity in America. And I think that some people really don't understand the purpose of it. See, in Africa, with the traditions and customs and things of that nature, they didn't make it what people are making it here today. They didn't make it a religion per se. You have to think to the African, the culture and the tradition is specific to their way of life and their everyday activity. Meaning that, you know, they don't go to church on Sundays or Fridays, Saturdays or Sundays, or Bible studies on Wednesday. They don't go to no holy. They don't need these holy temples and things of that nature. Okay. They did things. They put work in. And it justified their daily activities because it was an observation of their natural world that got them to where they are today. And I think that, you know, tying that back to what I said about the African mind, they go hand in hand. And, you know, Kofi touched on the other chapters and T'Challa's chapter about, again, learning again and again, he calls it the Acheron Echo Echo, which deals with the drum. That's something that he's really, really into, the drums, and how that plays a part in everything. So our chapters kind of tie into one another, just basically bringing you the traditions and the culture of African people.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Yeah, let me ask you one question, Vince, real quick. Just something to make a point, and if they may have ran across, and for our listeners as well. With all that, what you just said, and the different culture that is spread out, and going back to Egypt, but when they always show Egypt, they never talk about Maat there. They never talked about the spirituality, you know, with all this architect and the science and everything else that they cultivated and built, and they agreed that of the advancement of it, but they was it's okay for that advancement, but they never talked about the advancement of the spirituality. They never talked about the laws of Maat when you see it on the History Channel and things like that. So they put off like they was primitive as far as spirituality is concerned. They was just as high-tech in spirituality as they was in everything else.
Yes. We are coming up on 11:55, so our time has flown by, and unfortunately we won't be able to probe too much deeper into the book, but there are so many other things that we could have talked about and things that we must talk about moving forward. I know currently the research team is involved in a conversation or a debate about vaccinations, which present some very interesting ideas that we need to be privy to. And there's so much that we can learn about this. It is a research team, and I just have to say that these brothers do their homework. They do the research. They put the footnotes in. They make the references to the scholars who have come before them, and they make a very concerted effort to make sure that what they're bringing to you is based on scholarship and research and not just opinion. So I want to give you guys just a moment or so to talk about how folks can get the book and talk about some of the upcoming things that you have coming forward in terms of spreading knowledge. We got about a minute.
Okay. they want to get the book, they can go to kofipiesietv.com to purchase the book, or they can go to amazon.com also to purchase the book. Also, we have volume 2, Spirits of Pen, a historical survey in the minds of African warrior scholars, volume 2. Which will be out August the 14th. It'll also be on KofiPiesieTV.com, where you can purchase, or you can go to Amazon.com to get that work. And we also have other different publications I don't want to speak on at this time that will be coming out after Volume 2 come out on August the 14th.
Okay. I will say this. This is a book that you need to have. I can't emphasize that enough. I thought enough of the book to post it on Facebook, to do this show, to continue the dialogue with these brothers. We're going to be on Facebook Live with a Zoom video conference following some of the stuff that they're doing, as I mentioned before, around the anti-vax movement, or to vaccinate or not to vaccinate. What are the truths about this COVID-19 situation that we're going through? I think, you know, the fact that you guys have done your homework on that is something that can be very important and vital to the community of Black folk, because, you know, some of us are acting based on misinformation. If we can get the real information, it will benefit all of us. I'd like to thank Kofi Piesie and Ini-Herit, Shawn P. Khalfani, for joining us on 360 Info today. And I look forward to speaking with you brothers in the very near future.
All right. Appreciate for having me.
All right. Any closing comments or insight, Brother Hamptonio?
Yes. Just to remind folks, on the 25th, if you got a restaurant or a business place where customers come in, look for this local business coming in and tell you how you can keep your people and yourself safe on COVID-19.
Okay. And just wanted to remind you, if you were not able to hear the program, it's in its entirety. We are recording this program. It will be posted on my Facebook page, and it will also be posted on my YouTube channel. Please go to Vince Robinson on YouTube, like and subscribe. We will post the podcast as well as future versions of this program there. If you're interested in purchasing time, if you want to become a sponsor, you can reach out to Brother Stephen E. Boyd, and you can find him at 216-526-1297. That's 216-526-1297. We'd like to thank our engineer Tristan Sanchez for making sure everybody can be on this show and be heard so that you, the listening audience, get the benefit of what we do right here at 360 Info Network. Check out our Facebook page and check us out at newstalkcleveland.com. With that being said, everyone, know yourself, love yourself, be yourself. Make it a great day. Peace.
Peace.